Hello, everyone. Welcome to the space, the return of great power politics. I think it's safe to say that we're living through history. Anatoly Karlin should be here soon, and I think Master Shay could even jump on as well. I've invited him. And it's funny, it was only a few days ago that Master Shake and I hosted a space, and things were certainly escalating. Putin had recognized the breakaway regions in Donbass, and we made predictions. Master Shake was being very reasonable and sober. And I stuck to my guns. I was bold. I said that there was going to be a full invasion that would involve taking all of Ukraine. And unfortunately, I was correct. The reason why I've always said that this is a real conflict is that there's a structure to it. It isn't just some international dispute, diplomatic snafu or something. There is a very strong power structure to this. And I thought that Russia had real aims in mind. And again, it wasn't simply about, say, the coup in 2014, or it wasn't simply about Donbass, or it wasn't simply about Crimea. There was a bigger power structure at play. Putin had Or Russia had real war aims, and thus it very likely would lead to something. It's something that can't exactly be de-escalated with kind words. What I mean by this is that Putin, this is in many ways due to his own personal history, is attempting to reestablish a Russian sphere. In Karlin's words, he's bringing back the Russian lands. He is establishing something that certainly existed during the Soviet Union, but stretches back a long, long ways before that. Ukraine is a very difficult situation. Obviously, Kiev is there at the foundation of the Russian Empire. It's that kind of unity between Kiev and eventually Moscow. But it was a part of Russia, it was certainly a part of the Soviet Union. It has huge geographic strategic, it's of huge geographic strategic importance. We're talking about heartland Europe, as Mackinder talked about it, the pivot of world history, basically. There was a great deal of ambiguity with Ukraine for a long time, and Putin wants to end that ambiguity. I also think that Putin is certainly going to feel a lot of pain due to his decision to launch this invasion. Economic pain, I mean, the stock market has dropped 40%. I think it's factoring in all the sanctions and more. The ruble has been a very weak currency. I think it's been the most underperforming currency on world markets. But in a way, Putin is willing to go through that pain. He's willing to suffer that because this is about political aims, and economics come second. Economics support the political aims of reestablishing this imperial sphere. So this isn't really about nationalism, Ukrainian nationalism, or should we split up Ukraine into the Russian-leaning Ukraine or to the Western-leaning Ukraine? This is really about the establishment of an imperial bloc, which has a very long history, and again, is something that is always been there, but Putin wants to make what's ambiguous clear. He wants to make something that was maybe implicit explicit. He wants to basically find a solution for this matter. Okay. I can talk a little bit more. I'm waiting for Anatoly Karlin to jump in. Let me send him an invite. There he is. Oh, I can't send it to him yet. All right. Well, I will keep talking. I'll talk to him on DMs. Okay, he says he's coming on. So let me try this again. Bear with me here for a moment. Please don't leave. here we go. I got a request. Good. All right. Anatoly's coming in. Anatoly, welcome. Yes. Yeah, welcome to the space. How are you doing?
Very good, thank you.
Good. Well, I was struck by some of the pieces you've published at Substack and uns.com and so on. Putin is attempting to become a great man of history. I think that really nailed it. And I don't know if you heard my preface to this discussion, but, you know, to sum it up, you know, there are some serious issues involved with Ukraine. There are some humanitarian issues with the Donbas crisis. Sorry, my son is asking me a question. Yes, Alex?
I'm sorry, Mark, but you've got a
question. Okay, I have to, you have to go, sorry, my son wants to join the space. Alex, you have to show me the magic trick later. I'm sorry, sorry. Okay, hold on. Here. Sorry about this, guys. Here you go. Okay. I'll try to edit this afterwards. All right. What I was saying is there are serious humanitarian issues in Donbass. That's a real thing. There's just a lot of ambiguity. But at the end of the day, this isn't about those things. Those are maybe proximate causes or catalysts, however you want to think about it. This really is about reestablishing a Russian sphere. And so it is political, and anything economic or humanitarian is subordinate to this political motive. And do you agree with that, or do you want to add to that, Anatoly?
Oh, I mean, I said that all out in my sort of first article called The Gathering of the Russian Lands, in which I sort of guesstimated that this would get going on the 22nd of February, which ended up being pretty close to the mark.
Yeah.
So, yes, I mean, obviously, I do think that Putin is genuinely influenced by Russian nationalist thinkers who conceptualize the Russian nation as an old Russian nation, one that consists of great Russians, of Ukrainians and Belarusians, as per the I do think that frankly, I this is one of the reasons why I think that there's a pretty high chance that at least the territories of Novorossiya will sort of eventually end up being annexed in some way or another into Russia, whereas the sort of consensus seems to be that it would be a puppet state, with at most seeing like the expansion of the DNR and the LNR to their pre-war borders. Formal administrative borders. Although, in fairness, I do not think that this is exclusively driven to it, because, I mean, Putin has expressed some of these ideas since at least 2008, but he hasn't really followed through them consistently. I mean, I think that 2022 was basically an opportunity to do it, probably the best one since 2014. And my guess is that there will never be a better opportunity today afterwards, because I mean the Ukrainians have started building up a sort of an independent nation state that conceptualized themselves as a nation state that views itself not just as a sort of independent and separate from entirely separate from Russia, but as an anti-Russia. So yeah. You have restrictions on Russian language instruction. You have Russia being called Muscovy, and there's even the theory that Ukraine Russia is actually the real Russia, if you like talk to Ukrainian nationalists. And much of this has simply been adopted as state and ideology in the past 2 years under Zelensky. So I think there was these time factors which triggered it, as well as obviously Ukrainian military modernization. So I mean, it's clear that Ukraine does want to seize back the Donbass, and the Ukrainian military power relative to Russian military power is gaining simply because of the banal fact that Ukraine is starting from a much lower base, even despite its sort of economic problems. And the third timing factor, which I think is very much underestimated, is the Chinese factor. So China is much larger relative to the US in terms of GDP and military power and so on in 2022 than it was in 2014. And it's also now in a sort of economic cold war with the US, whereas back in 2014, this was sort of like the boom time of Chimerica, the sort of trade relationship between the US and China is now fragmenting as the US basically seeks to contain Chinese technological convergence via its actions against Huawei and so on. And as such, China has much, even as China has become much more economically powerful and technologically advanced, it's also sort of like downgraded its relationships, not even just with the US, but with Europe as well. So, I mean, yeah, there's like all these other sort of surface factors like Uyghurs and so on. But I mean, they do all underline the common sort of observation that we have the bifurcation of the world system into a sinosphere and the sort of the Western Empire, which I think is growing clearer by the year. So given the confluence of these various trends, I do think that that this is sort of like the critical factor that pushed Putin to resolve this Ukraine issue in 2022, simply because, yeah, in 2030, it will be harder than it is today. Putin might no longer be in power. So, I mean,
yeah, just this is not about Ukraine exactly. So you think that a Cold War arrangement with the West, America in particular, but the West and China is really significant? I mean, I know that I remember the Huawei thing and so on, but the Chimerica relationship for, you know, this phone that I am speaking on right now, among other things, is still going strong. Do you really see a kind of like bifurcation of the world system with China kind of leaving that, growing out of that Chimerica relationship, which has been going on for at least a quarter century?
Well, I mean, this is based on two banal observations. I mean, a lot of your sort of audience will be aware of HPD and national differences in IQ and that kind of things, those sure. kinds of things. So based on that, I'm making the assumption that over the long term, like by the middle of the 20th, by around 2040, in fact, Chinese GDP will be much bigger than the American. I mean, even if they just converge to the GDP per capita of Japan or South Korea, then it will be three times bigger. It will have more scientific output. It will have greater military power, even if it doesn't sort of like the PLAN is projected to converge with the U.S. Navy military power by around 2030, because it's adding the equivalent of a great power European Navy to every single year in terms of warship tonnage.
Yeah.
So bearing these in mind, you basically have either a unipolar world in which sort of the main the fulcrum of the world order has to shift to China simply by dint of its of its vast weight, essentially, or you have a bifurcation of the world system in which sort of the U.S. order the main sort of central to a more restricted Western sphere, which includes Europe and Japan, and there'll be active attempts to include India within that, although it seems that India sort of wants to pursue its own course. Yeah. And then there'll be a sinosphere, which will also sort of like dominate within itself. So I think that the short of like a major sort of ideological convergence, which including the overthrow of the CPC in China, and the dissolution of China's own sort of like territorial issues, because I mean, don't forget, I mean, they do genuinely view Taiwan as being a like a intrinsic part of China. I mean, it's a separatist renegade province essentially, and that sort of clashes with Taiwanese now, 80% of them feeling themselves to be their own country. Yeah. How you would go about resolving all of these issues in a world that remains unipolar, that sort of not sure that that's going to be feasible, essentially.
Yeah, I agree with actually a lot of what you're saying. I wonder if we're going to ever like fundamentally exit the Chimerica relationship in terms of technological goods, but we'll, you know, that remains to be seen. Do you envision?
I just want to add that the Chinese are good at applied things and copying the things and technological convergence. I mean, yeah. It does seem that sort of East Asians might struggle with innovation because of like some sort of like data conformism in general. Yes. In Central Asia, but since technological progress seems to be slowing down outside information technologies and biotech at any rate, it seems to me that over time the sort of relative importance of innovation might even decline.
Major new inventions are declining by many studies, so there's something to that. I don't want to dwell too much on the China question, but do you envision the Russian sphere being part of a kind of Eurasian economic system, or do you, what is that? I mean, or is the Russian, how do you see that unfolding?
I mean, in the event that relationships with the West get significantly sundered for a decade or so, there will probably be a decade Soviet Union 2022, Western Europe started recognizing it from the mid 2020s. The US recognized in 1933, so around a decade for like things normalized, right? So if we're looking at that kind of thing, then Russia is much less susceptible to sanctions now, because I mean, the past 8 years it has done a lot of efforts in terms of input substitution to wean itself away from dependence on the West, and you also have to bear in mind that to take a super extreme example, North Korea, which has 25 million people and they command economy, but it nonetheless exercises a lot of independence relative to China. That uncle whom Kim Jong-un shot several years ago, he was for being part of a pro-Chinese faction, essentially, as a sort of Korea watches. Yes, and I mean, Iran does, Iran gets by, and a sort of hypothetical Russia with 160 million people if Belarus joins, and if the maximalist scenarios come about and Ukraine is also in, then that's almost 200 million. So that's three times higher population than Iran. It's much bigger technological base, and it's probably something like 8 or 10 times the GDP. It's very hard for me to see how the Western sphere could essentially sanction it, because I mean, we do have to bear in mind that also Russia's main source of foreign currency and earnings, of course, is the high hydrocarbons sector, and you're not exactly going to be sanctioning the 10% or so of the world oil supply that Russia sells into the global oil markets.
Right. Interesting. I've been reading and listening to some of John Mersheimer's lectures, and they were quite good. He actually gave a lecture in 2014 on the Ukraine crisis, and it was titled "The Ukraine Crisis: Why It's the West's Fault," which, what wasn't maybe a bit of a clickbait title, I guess, but I think it. He lays out a lot of what I said at the beginning of this, which is that just a potential NATO power, just post 20 or in around 2014 is when you started to see this polling of very strong support of Ukrainians, particularly in the West, wanting to join NATO, very strong support wanting to join the EU. Those two things went hand in hand, even though they're clearly separate entities. And this was just basically a no-go for Russia. He said, why we he was basically saying that the United States needs to start moving away from heartland Europe, and the future of world power is going to be in Asia. We need to start concentrating on that and basically kind of let Russia take Ukraine. It's not worth it for us. I would, this is the way, I mean, I think, again, some kind of neutralization of Ukraine could have been interesting. That could have been a proposal by Russia-friendly administration like Trump's. That never happened. They never really did. They never had much strategic vision at all, the Trump years. But I at least what I imagine, I mean, I could see a full integration of Ukraine if this war is over shortly. I could also very well imagine a kind of German solution to the Ukraine question, and that is maybe a actual splitting of the country, with Kiev being a capital, maybe a split capital, just totally redo the German question, or Kiev being in the eastern half, and a kind of neutralization of the western half. Do you think something like that is a solution? Because Biden has made it explicitly clear. Now, of course, he might change his mind, but he has made it explicitly clear that there won't be boots on the ground. So what's going to happen is there is likely to be even more weapons sent into Ukraine. There is almost, again, there might be, I have seen some report that they were questioning this, whether this would trigger a NATO issue or not, if they're supplying arms to Ukraine. There is certainly already massive moral support and media support of Ukraine coming in from American media, European media, heads of state, etc. But in order to not just wreck this country and have some drawn out, insurgency or something, it seems like neutralization might be the kind of least bad option. I don't, I can't, that's at least how I'm seeing it now. That, this could have been done earlier. Maybe the West would just was better off just not pursuing things with Ukraine that it did, but this does seem to be kind of like the least bad option now if Biden is not, is, NATO is obviously not willing to support Ukraine. Ukraine's not a member. So what do you think? There's a lot of ideas there. What do you think about some of those things?
Well, absolutely, yes. I mean, historically, it's been pretty clearly established that verbal promises were made to Russia not to expand NATO after the Cold War, which were broken. And functionally, as you correctly note, that after the 1990s, the question of EU and NATO expansion were de facto linked. So, and it was also the EU which made the sort of European Association or the Eurasian Union integration a mutually exclusive affair. Obviously, I mean, opinions in the Ukraine, if you looked at polls from 2013, they were basically 50-50 on the EU versus Eurasian Union. So, I mean, either sort of direction would have involved half the population being unhappy with it.
And
that didn't come about. And in 2014, there was some sort of speculation that Putin was going to go in, but eventually they settled on another plan, which was to defend the DNR and the LNR and to push through the Minsk II agreements, in which they would go back into Ukraine while retaining autonomy, including control over their own local armed forces. And eventually it was assumed that with federalization, that the eastern provinces of Ukraine, which are more docile, they would naturally, due to cultural and economic links, gravitate towards Russia. But again, this was a no-go because of Kiev's dependence on the West, and because of the nationalists who hold a lot of influence over Ukrainian domestic politics. I mean, this was basically vetoed, any such thing. It seems that the Kremlin's found themselves facing this conundrum, in which 2022 seemed like a good year to solve this problem, in the sense that as I noted, Ukrainian military power relative to Russian was increasing, so you do need to have more and more troops on the borders of the LDNR to guarantee its independence in such a scenario. I agree with it. What will happen now? As regards your other question, I think that most likely we'll see some kind of hybrid solution in which I suspect that the LNR, DNR at the minimum will join the Russian Federation. I think that there's a high likelihood that Novorossiya will, possibly all the way up to the 1939 borders. Ultimately, it's pretty difficult to puppetize a state which is still big. Even without the Donetsk and Lugansk oblasts, Ukraine would still have 30 million people, and the population would understandably be extremely anti-Russian by that point. I mean, I'm certainly don't have any illusions about that. So how you're going to exert influence over it when you also have the EU and NATO on the borders, which are economically squeezing Russia, also for obvious and understandable reasons. I just don't see maintaining such a puppet regime as very feasible.
Yeah. Well, I mean, I also don't see maintaining a puppet regime as particularly feasible, because if there's one way to create national identity, it's to invade a country, in the sense of however Ukraine has, thought of itself previously, the experience of invasion and the experience of being downtrodden and oppressed or so on is a really strong identity formation event. And so I imagine that's just my sense of things, looking back at history and seeing what could happen, what has happened before and what could happen again, is that there will be some kind of division of the country, and with a kind of Western half being neutralized. I think in terms of just fully absorbing the whole country, I think that train has left the station. And, ironically, a blitzkrieg campaign to take over the whole country is going to just radically create national identity due to feelings of oppression, mm-hmm. basically. Go ahead.
I mean, I think that if the bulk of Ukraine is simply annexed, I don't think that this will actually result in that, because, I mean, it happened before. I mean, the Ukraine spent like three centuries, most of like the eastern part of it, at any date, under the Russian Empire, without with harmony in harmony for most of that time,
right.
And later in the Soviet Union. So the insurrection was concentrated in Galicia after World War II, and I mean this was a pretty interesting example, obviously, like Stalinism and so on. So if there is a sort of partisan campaign, I my strong prediction is that it will be limited to not to like Ukraine as a whole, but specifically not even Volhynia, but specifically Galicia. And I'm not actually sure it will even be that big of a concern, because I mean, it's hard to run an insurgency in the modern world where you have modern telecommunications. Ukraine has a average fertility rate of 1.3 kids. You have like you'd have people who are deeply dissatisfied can go to Poland or Czechia or whatever.
Yeah.
I mean, I'm not saying that this will happen. I mean, basically, you would have to weigh the advantages and disadvantages. So, as I said, the advantages of integrating all of Ukraine would be that you won't really have sort of like this extreme Ukrainian nationalist statelet in Galicia, basically serving as a ideological base for Ukrainian separatism. Also Ukrainians themselves might not be very happy about being as officially separated in this way, like
right.
even those who would otherwise be pro-Russian. And against that has to be weighed the disadvantages, of course, which is that the Galicia is the most anti-Russian region and the only one with a record of partisan campaigns. And also the Western region is also the poorest and most agricultural region, which even in the Soviet Union was a massive net recipient of welfare subsidies. From Russia and even from Eastern Ukraine. So yeah, I mean, there's different factors that you have to be weighed. I don't really know. I mean, there might be like various ways in which it can be done, like integrating Novorossiya directly into Russia and establishing a protectorate over the central regions and puppetizing the far western regions, or just letting them go independent, or mixing it up in various other ways. So obviously, I don't know what would be the optimal solution, and I'm not obviously don't know if that has been decided within the Kremlin either.
Right. There was a leaked document about division of the country, but you know, take that with a grain of salt, to say the least. Might very well have been a rough draft of a plan. Might have been a proposal that was rejected. Who knows? I'm going to bring in Master Sheikh. So I would like to say this. Each of us has a different perspective. And I think that Master Sheikh might have some strong disagreements. But I would urge everyone, we're, you know, there's enough killing going on. So let's be respectful. Although obviously we can disagree and be passionate about that. But I did not bring on Master Sheikh in order to create any kind of nastiness, but Master Sheikh, would you like to speak? You can comment about some of the things that Anatoly has put forward and express some disagreements or agreements or what have you.
Yeah, hi Richard. Dobrý вечер, Толик. Yeah, I kind of missed the beginning, the first about 15 minutes. I got on when you were talking about China. We can talk about China, or do you want me to get into Ukraine immediately?
Let's go Ukraine first, and then we'll circle back to China.
All right. When was that? Tuesday? We talked last time. And I sort of predicted that it would be limited to the Russian sort of invasion, or action would be limited to the eastern part of Ukraine, and that they would do some missile strikes and airstrikes. So Wednesday morning, I woke up and yesterday, I don't even remember now. The days seem so long now following the news all the time. But I woke up the morning that Putin announced the military operation in Ukraine. And in the morning, I sort of felt that, yeah, everything is just as I predicted. But as the morning went on, I sort of understood that, yeah, something is off. And yeah, he's actually doing it. He's going in, all in, into Ukraine.
Yeah.
It looks now that the major vector of attack is towards Kiev. And other fronts have also moved. They, of course, have liberated the Crimean water channel that they needed to supply Crimea with water, which is sort of understandable. But they haven't really moved far in the south. They're maybe making a move towards Mariupol in the southeast. But I really haven't followed the news in the last couple of hours. I've been a bit busy. So maybe someone else has. But yeah, I think that currently there are a lot of factors that I think we should talk about. Maybe Anatoly or Tolik, he can add in about what's the situation on the ground in Russia about anti-war protests. And as far as I know,
sure.
As far as I know, watching Russian television channels, official federal channels, they really aren't talking about a military operation in Ukraine proper. They're talking about only the operations in the east. And Putin, I think in his today's speech, also referred to the operations in Ukraine only as being limited to the Donbass. So all information is sort of suppressed regarding the full Russian invasion of Ukraine. So I would ask, maybe Anatoly can get into that, maybe talk about what's the word on the street in Russia itself.
Well, first about media policy, you're correct that it's sort of emphasized as a defensive, portrayed as a defensive operation to save the Donbass from a Ukrainian offensive, which, I mean, to be honest, was, I mean, obviously, yes, the Ukrainians have intermittently been shelling the Donbass for 8 years, but they haven't been shelling them more than usual. I mean, this was a totally artificial setup, of course. And usually, but I mean, in these cases, obviously, it's more instructive to look at the troop movements. The first predictions that something was up were made as early as November, simply because Russia was moving a lot of troops to around Ukraine. And it frankly, it became obvious to me, like when I started giving it a more than 50% chance, was in around mid-December, when the sort of the Far East military district was emptied out and transferred over to Bryansk, Voronezh, and so on. Obviously it's a multi-pronged offensive, and it seems to have absolutely maximalist aims, aimed at what I suspect will eventually be the occupation of Eastern Ukraine, obviously at a minimum, but possibly all of Ukraine. Because, yeah, I mean, most troop concentrations in Ukraine are in the east, so after that, it won't be, like, problematic going to the west. As regards public opinion, there's, according to opinion polls, it's sort of mostly either apathy or moderate support. I mean, obviously, the television cameras will focus on the opposition and the protests, but they seem to be, frankly, at the same size as the various Navalny protests, so around 10,000 people in Moscow, for instance, in a city of 15 million people. And the arrests, so like 1,000, I think it was in total, 1,500. Yeah, again, a typical arrest at a number of arrests for unauthorized waves of protest. Western journalists, they obviously talk primarily to people who rotate in their social milieu, which also gives another warped perception. I don't see any strong anti-war sentiment, and frankly, there's a lot of people, especially amongst the older generation, who sort of like from, I know one old lady from Odessa, for instance, who is very happy about sort of like being reunited with her home city after 30 years. Yeah, I mean, that's my assessment. I don't think obviously, if the war goes in a bad direction, then that would become extremely dangerous for Putin because people hate losers. But I think most realistic people would agree that this is exceedingly unlikely.
Well, it looks so far that the Russian military campaign isn't really that successive as they thought originally. I see reports of the aircraft losses about the same, about a dozen on the Ukrainian and about a dozen on the Russian side. Also, I see reports about Russians having pretty high casualties. So I think the body bags will start to come back soon. And I do believe that the public opinion in Russia will go towards being more anti-interventionism. There's also one thing I wanted to ask you. Maybe a month ago, there was this open letter by Russian or Soviet former officer association being against Putin and against his sort of military movements around Ukraine. And they were basically saying that, well, Putin should better take care about on the home front, about the domestic policy, and not to do any interventions or foreign entanglements around Ukraine. Was this something that you were aware of?
Well, I would address both points. The person you're talking about is Ivashov, is a completely marginal figure who has about 30 people in his organization, which has been completely blown out of proportion in the Western media. He's not the person who, I mean, he basically wants to, his position last time I checked, which was years ago, was that he wanted to bring back the Soviet Union. Now he seems to have some other positions, but he's an entirely marginal figure. The part about the casualties is that there's a fog of war, so it's extremely difficult to know what is happening. But the Russians have an extreme advantage in firepower, and artillery decides most things, because frankly, it's don't target the artillery, and it's very hard for Ukrainians to move openly across across open territory. Russians have total air dominance, total electronic warfare dominance. It seems extremely unlikely to me that real casualty ratios are anything but lopsidedly in Russia's favor. Although this is certainly the issue, because the main issue, of course, is that the only objective metric that we can sort of more or less verify through the fog of war is the position of the front lines. And what you have after essentially 36. I mean, the war has literally been going on for 40 hours, right? As of right now. And what we have now is basically all of Kherson Oblast, which is the oblast north of Crimea, being conquered. Russian troops being advancing on Nikolaev. They are on Kharkiv's outskirts, which is like the most probably the single most defended territory outside the Donbass. And they're on the outskirts of Kiev. They've taken Sumy. I don't think that that's sort of very logical. I mean, it took the Americans 3 weeks to go from the declaration, from the onset of hostilities with Iraq to taking Baghdad. And Russia is on the outskirts of Kiev after 40 hours. And U.S. intelligence was predicting that Kiev would fall within 96 hours, right, yesterday. So, I mean, obviously, there's a difference because obviously Baghdad was further away than Basta, and whereas Kiev was much closer and so on. But it seems to be broadly comparable. I think there's basically a lot of cope right now on the sort of like on Twitter regarding this issue, I think that over the next 2 to 3 days the true reality of the situation will become increasingly clear. And I mean, even now there's sort of preconceptions of that. If you're following Julian Roipke, who is the Bild correspondent, who's basically the last person you can accuse of having Zaldushian sympathies, who's very skeptical, pessimistic about the Ukrainian situation right now.
What do you think is going to happen to Zelensky? I mean, he seems to be, you know, to give him credit, showing a lot of bravery. Maybe those are propagandistic photos, but he is armed in Kiev. What is your, I mean, I calling for speculation, of course, but I mean, what do you think if this war goes as it has been going, what do you think the aim is for the current government?
As the God Zelensky, the person?
Yes, the person and the rest of the government, yeah.
Well, my sort of guess is that goal there is to capture them and give them show titles. But right. This is just a guess.
That seems likely.
And yeah, I mean, they have, I mean, every country, when it does that, they seek to sort of develop a government in waiting, right, on the sidelines. So there was that Kiva, former opposition bloc person who said that the government needs to be overthrown. There's Medvedchuk, who's imprisoned by Zelensky, who's sort of waiting in the wings. So various people you keep in reserve to so that you can sort of like place your own people in the sort of interim provisional government that you set up immediately after the occupation, much like the Americans had a similar thing with Iraq. Obviously, I mean it's what any sure. anybody would do.
Sure. Do you think there's going to be, I've seen a lot of, and I guess this maybe even Master Shay could take this. I mean, I've seen a lot of talk about NATO expansion to other countries, Finland, most notably, Sweden as well, which I, do you think this is going to be the result that, again, this kind of period of thawing and ambiguity is going to lead to a greater NATO expansion?
I would think that definitely. Yeah. These Russian movements are really making people nervous around the Baltic region, the Baltic Sea region. Pretty much everyone is, the people who have been saying that, well, the Eastern European countries should have been in NATO, they're basically vindicated, because my guess would be if there wasn't for NATO, I would be living under Russian occupation as well right now. So, and I'm kind of cheering for, rooting for Ukraine right now, because they're basically fighting our fight.
Right. Okay, let's do this. If anyone else would, well, actually, before we go to, we can take some questions from some of the people who are in here. You wanted to mention something, Master Shake, about China. I think you were maybe skeptical of what Anatoly was suggesting in his analysis.
Well, I absolutely agree that China is a major player and it will be a major player. But what I've seen recently, at least for the past couple of years, that China is more, they're more turning inward instead of going out doing stuff. During the Obama years, there was this term in international economics called the post-China 15 or 16 or something. It was sort of this theory about China actually becoming more developed, their living standards increasing, and that China would actually stop being the manufacturer of cheap goods, cheap electronics and things like that. It would become more technologically advanced and have a higher living standard. And countries in Latin America, Africa, countries like Malaysia, India would be part of this post-China, like 15 countries that would become the next sort of manufacturing centers of the world, and that China would actually sort of level out and maybe stagnate. And I think in the last couple of years, mainly due to COVID, of course, but there are some other factors within China. It sort of seems that it's true that China is more more worried about what's going on inside of China, and Xi is actually thinking more about domestic politics than going on the outside. So I don't really think China would become this like this global sort of ideological and military power as the United States was and still is, and maybe as the Soviet Union was in the past. So I wouldn't say that would be the end game with China.
Well, you know, one thing that I've noticed, I mean, we see, this is at least my view of the situation, and I, of course, might be wrong, but I obviously think the unipolar moment is over, and I think we're in a funny way kind of re-entering the 20th century. But it does seem to be a 20th century in which the ideologies of these blocs have been evacuated. And so obviously Russia, if we, you know, Russia is the, you know, center of the Soviet Union, it had a tremendous appeal to intellectuals in the West and really around the world as the ultimate progressive power, as, you know, unfurling the logic of history, et cetera. It had a German influence, you could say, and a Marxian influence to its vibe. It was very compelling. I can't really put into words what a current ideology of the Russian sphere would be. I'm
Soviet
sure
nostalgia.
One. Soviet it might nostalgia. Be a kind of, yeah, as they
no,
say
it's
in Germany,
absolutely. It's only Soviet nostalgia in my view.
Yeah. There's Ostalgie. I remember in Germany, you people driving around with Trabis and buying East German goods and so on. But yeah, I mean, there's a kind of trad element to it. Certainly the Orthodox Church has been, you know, more tightly integrated with the state and so on. But I don't find that to be very compelling. You do have some people in the West in the kind of Trump movement who are saying, oh, you know, Russia's cool. We love Russia. This just seems to be kind of projecting their fantasies onto Russia. I think the EU has, you know, a little bit of an ideology. It's just kind of liberalism, social democratic liberalism. But because of its origins, it did not have military origins, it had economic origins as the coal and steel conglomerate, I think it's kind of an empty vessel waiting to be filled in a way. The United States is, you know, obviously has an ideology. I think Americanism was one of the primary, obviously the primary ideology of the 20th century. But that's also been lessened. I mean, I think it's very clear that America is in terminal decline. I mean, we are literally in terminal decline in terms of our living standard and life expectancy and demographics and so on. There, America is also kind of seen as a villain often in Western Europe. I can remember traveling all across Central Europe and Western Europe when I was a little bit younger, and I didn't do this, but a lot of people who were, you know, in my boat would wear Canadian flags in their backpack or put the, you know, just so it's kind of like, oh, I'm not the one who invaded Iraq or whatever. So it doesn't have the punch that it does, obviously, in terms of like the production of culture making and movies and all that kind of stuff. It is still kind of emanating from the United States. But we seem to be entering this new 20th century like world, but it's one in which the ideologies have been evacuated, or in which the ideologies are kind of hazy or not particularly compelling in the case of Russia in particular, but even the United States. Either of you guys can pick up on that, or maybe you disagree with my premise that we're kind of re-entering the 20th century.
But, there's a thing that I wouldn't call it decline. It's more of a stagnation in my mind. It's not really that the economy or anything is collapsing. It's just sort of not growing anymore. Like the capitalist Western view is that there's needs to be growth all the time, but somehow, and also technologically and culturally, I don't want to mention them very, very much, but Peter Thiel, used to talk about that the ways you can measure a civilization or something like that, advances of civilization, is how far and how quickly can you get somewhere. And his main points were that, well, the Concorde hypersonic passenger plane isn't flying anymore, right, and that flying to the moon is what did. And the peak really was 50 years ago when people were flying to the moon and the Concorde was flying. And I think in a way it's something like that there's no longer a goal. The space program had a goal, and so it's also due to the lack of competition. Maybe now with China and Russia signing this deal that they're going to build joint lunar bases in the future, maybe that's maybe going to change that. But I think it's more of a going to be more of a private enterprise like Elon Musk and SpaceX, and I don't really think that Russia and China can really sort of compete with that, because they really, of course, they are technologically advanced, but Russia as well. They're flying the same Soyuz spacecraft they did 50 years ago, and it's real. And as Dmitry Rogozin has said himself, that Roscosmos is basically a black hole for money, where just money goes but nothing comes out. They haven't really developed new spacecraft or anything like that. Even though they had also funding from the European Space Agency and NASA as well. So it's very difficult to say, but I wouldn't call it a decline. It's more of a stagnation in my mind.
Right. But the America and the Soviet Union in the 20th century in some ways had very similar goals. It was a universal, either proletariat or middle-class society that was always advancing technologically and economically and leading to conquest and greater forms of happiness. And we couldn't even predict where we'll be. I mean, there was a lot of Soviet futurism as well as kind of American optimism. And I would say that, again, we're kind of re-entering the 20th century, but all of that has been lessened at the very least, if not completely evacuated. So anyway, I'm sounding some rather depressing.
Yeah, could I just add something? Ironically, I would have agreed much more with those takes 5 years ago. But the sort of distinctions have become more concrete, and it is linked a lot with the wokeification of U.S. discourse. And in terms of these differences being superficial, you could sort of describe, say, Russia's sort of stance against gay propaganda, for instance, laws as a mere the branding. But if you talk about later stuff, if you watch the latest Witcher, for instance, where they've sort of made every third character a black person. When I visited Poland in 2019, it was plastered full of these posters for the Witcher series, which portrayed this sort of quasi-European medieval world, fantasy world, where every third person was a black person, right? And this sort of Hollywoodization thing has also spread to the Wheel of Time and now the new Lord of the Rings as well. So just taking one example, there's also a lot of gender transition, transgender stuff, right? Which is totally foreign to Eastern Europeans so far. But the woke discourse is sort of seeping into Europe nonetheless, and along with it, the sort of the demographic component of that as well, due to immigration. Whereas in Russia, for instance, you've recently had cases where you had criminal cases brought against companies for discrimination against ethnic Russians for not sort of portraying the correct proportion of different races in advertising. So there was a recent case against Nike, for instance, Nike advertising. Because yeah, I mean, not like they have all the blacks that like advertising those clothes, and that this doesn't reflect our demographics. On blacks are less than 0.1% of the population. Why are you discriminating against the indigenous population? So these are ironically these sort of like right-wing memes have actually become more correct about Russia. I mean, once they were pretty far from reality, but it's increasingly like less distant from reality, I would say. And if people are interested in like looking up more examples of this, I mean, I have a huge article on this. It was my last big article at the UNS Review. It's called Russia's Nationalist Turn. So yeah, I one additional thing I would point out is that the sort of respective gratification of the world system between China and the US, and also the new Iron Curtain, which looks like it's going to spring up between Russia and the West. This sort of also results in a sort of mimetic petitioning of the new sphere. Of the mimetic world civilization. So these sort of woke memes will now find it more difficult to seep across borders, not just because of sort of less intense people-to-people connections on account of this, but also because of heightened antagonism between these civilizations. And yeah, I mean, you could even argue from a sort of like Rocco, who's listening to the space, as I see, he also raised this point that having this like extreme globalization is also an existential risk in a sense, because if some like very very bad miss very bad meme conquers the world, then that's it for civilization as a whole, human civilization. Or if some like virus like spreads.
Yes.
So I mean, yeah, he made the case for biogeographic quarantine, and maybe if he's interested, he could chime in on that.
Yeah,
Yeah,
I can
thank
bring him in a second. Yeah,
you.
Rocco, you could talk about this. I think I might disagree with this, but go ahead.
Yeah, I mean, I do think the fate of the world has become a lot more correlated. And just to touch on what Anatoly has said, I've been talking to some people from Croatia because I'm half Croatian, and apparently, all the woke stuff is now popular in Zagreb. They have like sort of posters of black people and transgender and all of this stuff, which is completely antithetical to, sort of Croat or Yugoslav culture, but it's kind of been pushed in. And what people are telling me is, well, the NGOs turned up and NATO and political pressure and politicians were weak and so on and so forth. So you can see these memes, and I'm not necessarily saying I disagree with these memes at this point. I'm just pointing out that they do tend to spread, and if they are bad, which you can make arguments that they are dangerous, then they take everything down all at once.
Yeah. I mean, I would simply add, I don't fully blame America for all of this. I think this is a kind of unfurling of a particular logic, a particular kind of European nihilism and liberalism that is actually infecting all of us. One of the ironies, greatest irony perhaps, of the Cold War is that godless communism protected Eastern Europe from the ravages of liberalism, and it did that. And it is a great irony where, a regime that was considered the most progressive of all time has, because of its perhaps because of its the separation between the powers and because of its just economic inefficiency, it kind of allowed. It kept Eastern Europe kind of in the past, but I do think that they are behind, and they aren't really charting a new path. I mean, once Instagram is installed in the national phone, it is really only a matter of time before we start seeing the kind of woke insanity that we see in the United States. And I shouldn't even call it insanity because it has a very particular logic to it. It's not merely insane. It is actually a kind of logical unfurling of these very deep memes that I think are actually everywhere. So I don't ultimately think the former Soviet Union will be immune to this. Although, sure, if there is a new Iron Curtain falling due to the invasion of Ukraine, which clearly seems to be happening, that could retard that effect. But basically, I think wokeness is a horrifying virus that you cannot escape. And maybe I'm saying this because I'm American, but I don't even fully blame America for this. I think that's a kind of easy way out of saying, oh, it's the NGOs, or it's woke capitalism, it's HR departments, it's advertising departments. Obviously, they play a role, but I don't think they're actually originating these kinds of things. So I think everyone in the West is going to either succumb to this virus, or you have an immune system. You hate it with such a passion that you'll be able to survive it. But that's simply my take.
Yeah, a couple of points. I don't really think that Eastern Europe is 20 years behind or something. I think it's the same, actually. And maybe the reason why it isn't so pronounced, or it doesn't go to any like these crazy lengths it does go in America, is just because we are racially or ethnically more homogeneous. And I think the more diverse the population is, the more crazier this wokeism also is, because you need to talk about minorities, you need to appease them and things like that. So in that sense, I think that's the main reason why it goes so far in the West. But here, I mean, I'm also following some, once in a while, I look at the Russian TikTok and read Dvach, which is like the Russian version of 4chan. And it's pretty much the same kind of stuff that you would see in Western kids posting on their feeds. So they're talking about LGBT rights and stuff like that, even in Russia, especially in Russia. As a matter of fact, I know not a lot, but a few Russians from St. Petersburg, and they are actually pretty liberal and pretty like woke, but I think they do it more in spite of their country or something like that. You could call them self-hating liberals or something like that. I think Anatoly is going to make a point about it, but I don't really think that they are an exception. I think there definitely is also like this woke thing in Russia as well, but it's very sort of behind the curtains, very sort of underneath the everything. People just don't see it, but I definitely feel that it's there.
Right.
I mean, it obviously exists, but I mean, it's undeniable that it's at a much sort of less advanced stage than it is in Western Europe, or especially the US. I don't think there's any reasonable doubts about this. And yeah, I mean, especially young people, St. Petersburg, you know, that's a specific demographic. Even places like Dvach. Yeah, I mean, they exist, but you also have like a lot of like edgy humor there, that you wouldn't really find on Reddit, for instance.
Yeah, it is edgy, but it's also like dissident, anti-Putin. You would agree with that, I think.
I agree. I mean, obviously, on average, the young people in Russia, especially those who hang out on like discussion boards, they're more anti-Putin on average than older people. I mean, if you look at ideology, then older people are more sort of communist and pro-Putin, and the younger people are more nationalist and more liberal, ironically. So that's sort of like the ideological spectrum. And I allow that Putin sort of meta shift toward in a more sort of nationalist direction, which even includes some aspects of ethno-nationalism, in my opinion, although it's a very controversial one, probably had something to do with the sort of like electoral demographic patterns.
I think we could use the opportunity and Anatoly being here, maybe talk about Kazakhstan in a little bit. But first, just one point about the sort of notion that communism and Soviet Union sort of protected Eastern Europe, and why it's so maybe trad or nationalist, right, or something, right, like that. I think that, well, coming from the Baltics and having this Soviet experience of hard military occupation for 50 years, that sort of feeds your nationalist sentiment, and you need to have like be suppressed physically, be suppressed by military occupation, like to have this feeling of resistance of something. Yeah. And actually we had quite strong national movement in the late 80s, which was actually not that much against communism or Soviet policies, but the Soviet policy of forced immigration from other places in the Soviet Union to the Baltics. So actually the first protests that eventually led to like anti-Soviet protests and things like that were actually anti-immigration protests. The people didn't want to have more workers coming in from other parts of the Soviet Union, especially from Russia. So this is, I think, is the one of the reasons of the strong nationalism that you had. And when you lose that, when you lose this hard military occupation, when you no longer have like this boot on your back, then you sort of get lax and you sort of lose this your nationalist strong sentiment in a while. But I think the events in Ukraine sort of have again stirred it up, and there's more sort of nationalist. Today there were massive protests next to the Russian embassy, and there's definitely echoes of that, what happened in the late 80s and early 90s here.
Right. Yeah, I mean, yeah. If Ukraine wasn't a nation before, it will be after this experience.
Yeah, definitely. Definitely. Sort of. So Putin and Russia, I think they're sort of, what they are doing, they're actually creating what they don't like, that they don't want, which what they claim they're opposing, they're actually creating more of it by their actions. So I think that's an interesting development.
Yes, yeah, so Ukraine might actually become Nazi due to this experience, whereas it obviously wasn't before.
does that apply to just the ethnic Ukrainians, or to the, like, are the ethnic Russians in Ukraine going to suddenly want to, you know, change color and become blue and yellow? I mean, maybe Anatoly can speak to that.
Well, I mean, I think it was inevitable anyway, because of the policies of the post-Soviet Ukrainian elites, which were aimed at nation building and distancing from Russia, as I pointed out at the beginning. And obviously this will go at varying rates. Some will be cardinally unhappy with this and will eventually emigrate from Ukraine. Others would simply fully assimilate. So I mean, it's well known that Ukrainians assimilate like extremely easily into Russian society, and frankly, it's true in the reverse as well. Simply because the culture and the genetics are so close. But I don't think that the main component of nation building is, at the end of the day, the schools, and obviously conflicts do play a role. But I mean the electoral patterns that we see in Ukraine now, they have existed across even after the Euromaidan and the Donbass rebellion. You had this east-west sort of gradient before that, and this will remain, although over time it will be flattened, progressively flattened.
Okay. All right, Dan, Rowdenbush, would you like to jump in?
Good evening, Mr. Spencer. Thank you for having me on.
Sure.
Dobrý večer, господин Karlin. I'd like to bring up two points. The first, that we are seeing a whole lot of copium going around from the pro-Western people, especially regarding casualty rates, you know, success percentages, this kind of thing. I'm sure we've all seen it. There's no evidence to go on. I think it's very important that we be aware this is very likely part of an effort to portray the Russian attempt as weak and thereby Russia as weak to justify Western involvement in Ukraine militarily. There is clearly an effort going on to portray Ukraine in a positive light and develop an emotional outrage from Western populations. The second thing I wanted to bring up regarding what you gentlemen were talking about, I live in Russia now. There is very clearly strong influence here in the younger populations. It goes beyond a very minor thing. You can tell it in the way that people dress. You see the same multicolored hair and that kind of thing. And these people, they are pretty heavy left-leaning in a social manner, not just a economic one. This is something that I hope that the Russian intelligentsia, especially among your people,
that
aware of.
Yeah. So I met a girl whose dad is works for a KPRF, and it's pretty interesting because it's not like the old Slovak communist type of person, but more like a left-wing liberal that's rich, affluent, that has a private driver. So Russian politics were changing, and you know, the kind of old communist party types are kind of disappearing and being replaced by these kind of more Western woke liberals. At least that's my opinion from what I'm seeing.
Yeah. Well, I would push back just a little bit on what Dan was saying. I mean, Biden has been quite explicit about no boots on the ground. I think, and I even saw one report, and it was in a mainstream, because I've been the New York Times or the Washington Post, about a concern of supplying weapons to Ukraine in the sense that that might trigger some kind of NATO involvement. You know, after all, if you're giving weapons to a group that's fighting somewhere, are you not, in a sense, fighting as well? There at least is some concern about that. I don't know. I don't see it. I think it's much more likely that I think it's likely that there's a long-term nasty and bloody insurgency that is to a degree funded by the West and certainly inspired by Western media portrayal. I just don't see it, like full NATO involvement. If I could make a prediction, again, might very well be wrong. There's going to be some kind of division or neutralization at the end of this. Now, can you find some neocons who want a land war in Central Europe? Of course you can. I just don't think that. I don't think Biden is among them. That's just my perspective.
I agree that the chance of NATO involvement is essentially zero. I agree with Dan's point, however, that the Ukrainians, I mean, you can understand the Kiev regime's interest in sort of portraying that it has a fighting chance because, frankly, the Westerners have fled to Lviv and many of the embassies have left Lviv as well now. So, really, that's a strong signal to the soldiers to defect. So they have morale problems, and if this starts going, then it's going to be the collapse is going to be very quick, very quick. And they want to. There does seem to be enthusiasm for a last stand, and so you need to keep coming up with these stories. Many of which have actually started being ended up false. So, for instance, there were reports that the Vedove, which sees that airport near Kiev, was sort of destroyed, and then it emerged that no, it wasn't. It actually held on, and now the ground forces have linked up to them, like literally half several hours ago. And there was also that report about the Russian bomber, which was shot down over Kiev by Ukrainian anti-air assets, which hadn't been destroyed by Russian ballistic missiles. But it later emerged that it was a Ukrainian Su-27 that was brought down by Russian anti-aircraft in the vicinity. So yeah, I mean, you do have a lot of these stories which basically turn out to be false after some fact checking. And I think this is important to bear in mind. I mean, we covered this earlier, but I'm also extremely skeptical that there will be any kind of real guerrilla warfare afterwards, because historically there was nothing of the kind when, like, Russia had sort of like occupied or reunited with, like, however you want to call it, with Ukraine in previous ages, with the exception of Galicia, which specifically had never been united with the Russian lands, the bulk of the Russian lands, since literally the 12th century. So, I mean, yes, it's legitimately a different civilization by now. So, yes, as a Russian nationalist, I freely acknowledge that and don't even particularly want it to, like, be part of my sort of, like, Russian sort of super civilization. But yeah, I mean, that aside, and another thing you have to bear in mind is that in the modern world, it's very difficult to sustain a partisan campaign simply because of modern technology. I mean, you need a hard sort of ideology for this. Like many of the Azov types, they are subscribe to those ideas because they have nothing better to do, essentially, and many of them would be happy to just emigrate. There was a interesting article about this, like profiling one of them at Palladium Mag several days ago, incidentally. You have modern people rely on telecommunications. All the telecommunications in Russia, they go through a certain building in Moscow, which houses an organization called SODM. Artificial intelligence mines those communications. If you consistently talk about sort of, terrorism or partisan related things, then they'll catch on to that pretty quickly. I mean, the Chechen terrorism hasn't existed essentially for a decade now, and the technologies for this are drastically better now. You have face recognition cameras like in Moscow, which are almost as dense as in London, for instance, to take another example. It's just a really hard thing to do, essentially, under conditions of the modern information technology age, much harder than it was in the 1940s, for instance.
Yeah, I'm also bearish on any kind of insurgency. I feel like Western media is hyping up the Ukrainian morale the more than it's really worth. I don't think anyone would be motivated to do that.
Well, there are at least 100,000 men who have gone through the anti-terrorism operation in the Donbass on the Ukrainian side. So you think that they're just going to disappear?
I mean, I think you need broad popular support for a sort of insurgency. And I mean, I'm not really an expert on this stuff, but
I think the annexation of Crimea and the ongoing Russian operations in the Donbass have actually fueled Ukrainian national sentiment for the last eight years as much as anything else could. So I think that they're definitely not going to just give up without the fight. And of course, certainly I'm a bit biased, but I don't think that it's going to be an easy thing for Russia, especially if they do a long-term occupation.
Yeah, I tend to agree with Master Sheikh, but again, we'll see.
I think that the Chechen experience was much more extreme, and there were like much more powerful ideologies at play. So Islamism, you had plenty of guys who were literally willing to spend years in forests, not in like talking with each other in
cities. Terrain too was
yes, the terrain that's full of forests and mountains, whereas Ukraine is just flat territory, well apart from the parts of the far west, but that's what I'd end those comments at.
Yeah, I mean, I'm just imagining an ordinary Ukrainian guy caring enough about the difference between Zelensky and Putin to actually put his life at risk, and I'm struggling.
Well, the last years have fed the anti-Russian sentiment in Ukraine very strongly, so I wouldn't really put that down. I think that's pretty important.
Yeah, we'll see. We have a disagreement. It's fine. We'll figure it out. All right, I'll go to Let, and then Brendan, and then Boris. So Let, you can go first if you have a question or a comment.
Yes, thank you. Thank you, Richard. Thank you, gentlemen, for having me. I have two quick points this evening to talk about. The first one is on the notion of the wokeness, and to go on a bit of a rant, let's say I play a bit of a devil's advocate to this Western wokeness. I think, and to agree with you, Richard, a bit, I think it's a universal thing when it comes to social media and to pop culture, that when you look at Russia's pop culture, you see the same hip-hop, rap, it's quite popular, the same woke stuff, you could say, with Timothy, with Morgenstern, and with these kinds of musicians, if you call them. They are quite popular, and they are really the same Lil Pump and whatever you have in the West. It's essentially the same. Now, the difference is they play a bit of a footsie, or they bend the knee to Putin and his actions, and so they somehow get a free pass, you know. And you can see other popular musicians and actors such as Kirkorov, who I would say are very woke when it comes to their musical works, to their expressions. And also when it comes to wokeness in Russia and the notion of Putin being an ethno-nationalist, I'd be a bit skeptical about this. There's a good article by Al Jazeera done in 2017, I think. It's titled "Death of the Russian Far Right." If I can find it, I will post it here. And it essentially said that that back like 10 years ago, or so Russian cracked down on anti-immigration movements that were quite white nationalist and ethno-nationalist. If you could call them, there were two guys, I think. Let me check. Yes, Alexander Potkin. There was this another dude who were quite skeptical and of the increased Central Asian immigration in Russia, and they were essentially jailed, and I think they are still jailed and remain under arrest for the speaking out on these issues. So I wouldn't be that determined to say that Putin has taken such an ethno-nationalist role. And I see that Nikopol is here as well. And in our discussion some time ago, the last time, he said that Russians have two words for, similar, but the different ones for like determining or explaining their nationality. You have Ruski, which is Russian as an ethno-nationalist term, and you have Rossiyani, which is like a more civic nationalist one. So I think that Putin still employs some kind of essential center-right, center-left position to expand his Russian, so to say, sphere of influence. And that would be my point on the so-called ethno-nationalist position in Russia. And I wanted to pivot back a bit to the current situation, and I wanted to hear your opinions on the European response, which has been detrimentally different. If you look at the Scholz and Germany, who have their own interests with the Nord Stream and with the gas imports and such, they are a bit slower to take action and with the sanctions. And then again, you have Macron, who I hope takes the lead in the European stage. And really, for instance, today he was at the European Parliament meeting, council meeting, sorry. And as I quote, he said that the war is here on our soil. In the tragic times we live in, Europe has no choice but to become a power. And right. So you can see there are two different approaches in the European Union alone. And I wanted to hear your opinions on which opinion will prevail, and whether Macron can really put his rhetoric into action and maybe unite Europe as a whole and maybe turn it from a purely economic powerhouse, if we can call it powerhouse, to a military one.
Okay, Two things. First of all, I just as a background, I come from the same university as Macron, so I know his milieu. I've actually met some of his friends. So I think we shouldn't underestimate the power of groupthink. And since pretty much, you know, Putin's invasion made everyone kind of catatonic, like they just couldn't believe it, right? They've gone historical over it. So I think we shouldn't underestimate like the kind of WEF Davos elite's power to create a recession by doing stupid stuff like disconnecting Russia from SWIFT. I think it's actually like an option, especially as more, you know, cool voices from the older generations like Draghi are kind of, you know, going out of the picture, and you have people like Macron that kind of went into politics in the 90s and all that. Second, it's never going to translate into hard power because these people, they just don't have, you know, the kind of long-term focus, cynicism, kind of will to power that, say, you'd see with like the Soloviks in Russia, you know, that this kind of, you know, will to kind of, you know, drive a hard bargain and, you know, actually put people like on the line and sacrifice lives. They just don't have it. And we're going to have all this massive, and people are going to ask for government handouts, all that, and there'll be fuel inflation.
We're getting a breakup here. Let me just mute you for one moment. Master Sheikh, would you like to respond? I mean, in terms of the Macron question, I mean, the certainly bold words. Macron is a, you know, egomaniac who has the spirit of Napoleon in him in some way. I mean, again, I'm a Macron fan. Do you think there's going to be some kind of, you know, like, actual that a crisis will create something that otherwise was slow to arise or might not have arisen at all, and that this kind of crisis, you know, is going to create a kind of European bloc that is militarized, maybe in alliance with NATO or in parallel with NATO? What do you think about these issues?
Well, I mean, first, there really is no need to have like a separate European and NATO thing, because that would just be like Europe without America and Canada.
Right.
I think that like forced integrations or these weapon systems, they're already integrated. So it would just be a sort of a political statement, a political kind of thing, more or less, than nothing practical. But of course, if we're thinking long term, looking at the situation and polarization in the U.S., I think definitely there should be some sort of a backup option for Europe that you can't really, maybe in the future, you won't be able to rely on the United States as much. So the strategic autonomy, I think it's somewhere there in the future, not right now. But as for European unity, I think this Russian action, invasion, and war in Ukraine has already showed that since Tuesday or Wednesday, I think that there are already, even Germans are now agreeing on the SWIFT sanctions against Russia. So, I mean, yesterday there was some bickering in the EU Council from Belgium, who disagreed. They wanted to be able to import diamonds from Russia so they can make expensive jewelry, and Italy so they can export luxury goods to Russia. But if you take that, if you just get over that, I mean, there's absolute unity. Germany has now declared they're going to stop the Nord Stream 2. If the situation continues to develop, if Russia goes further, maybe going to Moldova next or something like that, there are plans. I've heard in news that maybe some pundits are saying that maybe we should just completely stop relying on, stop buying Russian gas and oil and things like that. I mean, these things are, we'll have to see how the situation develops, but certainly people are starting to talk about this. They would have never talked about this before. So there's definitely a movement in this direction of this like united front in Europe.
Yes. Okay, let's go to Boris and then Brendan. So Boris, you first. You have the floor.
Hello, Richard. Hello, Master Sheik. Good evening, good afternoon. Just a couple of remarks on the topic of this space of the great power politics. As I was thinking about the kind of the new reality, I agree with Richard's and pretty much everyone else's, I suppose, assertion here that the unipolar, the era of the unipolar world is coming to an end, and we're going to be seeing several large players of comparable size and comparable wealth and comparable potential otherwise that that will be competing. What I'm struggling to see is how Russia can be one of those players. I'm not seeing the offering that Russia can bring to the table that will establish it as one of the great powers. There is no technology or base that can produce technology along the lines of Silicon Valley or any other engine that's established and that's kind of that is it's like a chain reaction basically. There's as long as you commit resources, it'll produce people who will come up with new things that have value and that increase the footprint, economic power, and in some cases even potential projection of force. The reason Russia is front and center right now, and we're talking about it as a great power, is really a vestige of the last 70, 80 years. It's nuclear arsenal, Europe's dependence on its natural resources, and first and foremost, hydrocarbons, and some other smaller things like its place as a permanent member of the UN Security Council and kind of the residual influence that it still has in its general sphere of influence. Now, what's happening right now as we see it, first of all, Europe seems to be waking up that to the fact that its complacency and its excessive dependence on Russian energy has made it vulnerable and has limited the options that it has in reacting to challenges that Russia all of a sudden poses. Now, I'm pretty certain that in the next few years, regardless of how the current situation resolves, there'll be a pretty strong push to, and it's already happening, to wean European industry and consumer sector off Russian hydrocarbons. That means that Russia will have to turn east in order to sell hydrocarbons and to be able to feed the economic model that it's chosen. And the economic model is that of a petrostate, essentially. Its industrial base is decrepit. It's declining. There isn't much new that's going on there. So it's a redistributive model where you sell something that you dig up from the ground, and then you distribute that revenue throughout the various client groups that in turn perhaps provide or produce other goods that are necessary for the society to function. Now, what that means is Russia becomes a single client provider of many things, primarily commodities. I think one other area that Russia is still a very big player in is agriculture, but it's also, it specializes in low yield, low value crops like wheat. And it's not a very productive producer of wheat of yield. So it's a price taker in the market. So it's, I mean, and so as Russia's dependence on China increases as a result of Europe making that conscious effort to switch to other sources of commodities, Russia's leverage in terms of pricing, in terms of diversifying its supply routes or export routes decreases. So its bargaining power decreases. So the economic yield, the economic benefit of that activity goes down. So which kind of leads to economic stagnation, diminishing wealth creation, and so forth. On the other hand, China, I would gently disagree with Master Sheikh here that China is, there are certainly some signs that China is increasingly looking at its own issues, and it's got plenty of issues. Its economic model that was successful throughout the 80s, late 80s and 90s and the last decade, which is to copy or steal technology. And it's not the cutting edge technology, but something that can be easily turned into consumer goods produced with a cost advantage and sold back to the same countries where the technology came from. That model is running out because China is no longer the lowest cost producer. I mean, you can see now, you know, a very anecdotal example, like when you buy a cell phone now, chances are it's not going to be made in China. It's going to be made in Vietnam or India or places that are kind of lower on the cost scale there. And China is now, yes, China is going up the food chain. Instead of just copying Western technology, it's now beginning to develop its own. It's gotten a couple of generations of people who went to study in the West and came back and started their own companies and, you know, were schooled in local technical and engineering schools. And it's got that critical mass now that it does not depend on copying or stealing Western technology. And as long as I remember, at least in the last 15 years, I seem to, whenever I talk to people about what's going to happen to China, everybody keeps telling, oh, it's just about to collapse. Its banking system is overleveraged. It's just loaded with very murky non-performing loans. So it'll take a little nudge and that whole house of cards is going to collapse. It hasn't happened. I mean, they've gone through kind of shaky situations, like the most recent one with the real estate developers, but they always seem to gain control over what happens next and not allow it to become a system-wide problem. So what I see happening, just summarizing what I was going to say, Russia will likely increasingly play a role of commodity appendage to China. And China is turning not just Russia, but largely Africa, and now more recently parts of Latin America into parts of its kind of supply chain or wherever it goes to source or to sell their stuff. So basically it's building its own system of production cycles and division of labor and all that stuff. So Russia will be dependent on China, and it'll play a second fiddle at best to China. So and I agree also with Richard's suggestion that we'll probably see some consolidation in the West. There'll be kind of Europe will at some point recognize that now all of a sudden there is a geostrategic adversary. And I believe it's going to be the China and perhaps the greater China with some of its economic satellite countries. And it'll probably bring the West together along the lines of kind of center-left, center-right politics, where you won't have the luxury of going on limbs and doing fanciful stuff. I'm not sure actually what happens with the woke tendency. It'll probably peter out at some point, because again, when it's flourishing when people feel that they can afford it, when there's more hardship and more, you know, they feel like there are more challenges of a practical nature, that thing very quickly kind of fades into the background. So that's,
yeah. Well, I engaged in some wishful thinking, admittedly, about woke peaking. I mean, it has to peak at some point. I think my general point is that the Trumpism stuff, this kind of hyper polarized wild populism, doesn't really have anything to add to this moment. It doesn't have the geopolitics. It's almost has a kind of schizophrenic geopolitics, in the sense that, you know, it's Trump declared Putin a genius and then claimed that this would never happen under my watch. And it kind of flips between projecting fantasies onto Russia or being hyper anti-Russian, and we need to, you know, confront Putin. It just, you know, we need to get out of Afghanistan, but then when we get out, oh, who lost Afghanistan? I mean, it just doesn't know what it is. And it just includes a lot of people who are not very intelligent doing a lot of talking. And so I do think there's just going to be consolidation. It's, you know, wokeness can't go that much further. And it's not going to, I think Biden is kind of like an example of the kind of politician that we might see in the near future. And I think the wild populism has seen its day, but that's just I might very well be wrong about that. Okay.
Richard, just one quick remark to finish it off. I forgot to mention also that Russia is in a fairly steep demographic decline.
Yeah.
The net decrease in population last year was about 1 million people, off the base of about 144 million. Granted, a lot of it is COVID, but still, and even without COVID, the declining trend is there. There were a couple of years when it kind of reversed, but marginally so. And I just simply cannot think of another example of a country that is largely a commodity producer, and that is facing an economic decline, of having a credible prospect of being a superpower in any foreseeable future. Thank you.
Yes.
Well, they have nuclear weapons, though. I mean, that's a pretty big deal.
I would actually add that this is
India and Pakistan.
Hold on. Anatoly first, and then Master Shay.
Yeah, I mean, the demographics point just simply isn't entirely accurate, because, yes, I mean, Russia had catastrophic demographics in the 1990s to early 2000s. So the fertility rate was at around 1.3. Then it peaked at 1.8, began increasing from the mid-2000s, peaked at around 1.8 in the mid-2010s, and is now at around 1.52, which is actually entirely typical by European and white American standards. In fact, we've actually seen basically a convergence of fertility rates to around 1.5 across a broad swathe of the world's industrialized nations in Northern Europe and the Anglosphere, and Eastern Europe for that matter, to 1.5, which is not great, not particularly terrible. For instance, it's actually much significantly lower in Poland, at around 1.3, despite its sort of like that credentials.
You've got to be careful when you say something is not great but not terrible in a Russian accent. It'll make people novel movie.
I mean, it's interesting because of all the Eastern European countries, Russia has like the best TFR, like Moldova, Latvia. Like, it actually has like the best one, quote unquote. So from a purely relative perspective, it's doing okay. I think it has a bit better TFR than Germany too, so not a problem.
Master Shake?
Yeah, I didn't hear the last part, what you said about Latvia. Can you please repeat that?
Like, you guys have like 1.2 TFR, 1.3.
Like, that's a Russian replacement, right?
Yeah, like Russia has a higher TFR than other Eastern European countries, and so it's not really a limiting factor per se. And I mean, it's like a global phenomenon. It's you know, kind of rural peoples, like white Asians, are pretty much everyone is below replacement rate. So it's kind of like a false dilemma. And I mean, like, Boris brings up all these problems about China, but China has both quantitative advantage from industry standpoint. Like, they have like a massive heavy industry, like the biggest by far. Like, it's not even a comparison when you look at steel, cement, etc. And from a qualitative aspect, they're also number one in terms of quality weighted scientific papers. So it's really not a, I don't see what's the point.
Well, right? China is very ascending. Boris was saying the opposite. He was saying that there in Washington, D.C., you can find dozens of think tanks where they're always declaring that China is about to collapse. Boris was saying the opposite. He was saying that Russia is going to be a little brother to China. They have reached a kind of critical mass in terms of innovation and scientific discovery and so on, and maybe even slowly moving away from Chimerica.
Since Russia has a problem with investment, that there's a lot of capital flight, because Russia has a very peculiar economic model. So all capitalist countries, they have like a...
Well, you're breaking up again.
With the declining profitability of, you know, as markets expand, et cetera, the profitability falls. But Russia always has this kind of natural resource rent. That means that Russian millionaires get like a shit ton of money. I mean, throughout history, if you look at like the Russian Empire, got rich of logging, fur trade, et cetera. So that's interesting what's going to happen if Russia, you know, if Russians can export capital and they're forced to invest it domestically, what's going to happen? Because there's huge like potential for infrastructure development, for instance, in Russia that hasn't been done in the years past.
Mm. All right. So what I think about birth rates is that I'm not really a believer in that you necessarily need to have a large population or something. Maybe that's just because I'm from a smaller country, but I rather have a smaller amount of people, but better people. So that would be my take. As far as Russian demographics, aren't the positive trends in Russian demographics because of the Chechen population and other minorities, but the Russian population is actually stagnating?
No, Anatoly. They play like
a very marginal role. Hold on, BBB. Okay, I don't want to be rude here, but you're not one of the featured speakers. So, Anatoly, do you want to jump in on that?
In terms of demographics?
Yes, on the demographics.
Yeah.
Master Sheikh was suggesting that the demographics might be a bit of an illusion because of Chechen demographics and something
and other.
Sorry. Yeah, okay, yeah. I wanted to clarify that, yeah, because...
Quality.
I mean, that sort of broke up for a bit. Yeah, about the Chechens. Do you want to guess what percentage of the Russian population Chechens are?
I think it's about 5%, maybe.
Small, no, it's 1%.
What?
It's 1%.
Oh.
There's 1.5 million Chechens. So the fact that they have a fertility rate of 2.7 kids, which is slightly lower than Israel, by the way, doesn't really have a bearing on Russian demographics. And even if you count all the Muslims in the South Caucasus, that's around 5 million, 5 to 6 million people. So the population of Russia is around 145 million. It's just not significant. I mean, obviously you have Tatars and Bashkirs, for instance, but they're basically fully Europeanized. But they're basically fully Europeanized Muslims, essentially, and sort of like demographic and psychometric profiles don't really differ from ethnic Russians at all. So frankly, this is a nothing burger, in my opinion. And to the extent that we're talking about diversity, I mean, I would argue that that there are several European countries, like such as France, which have basically created more in the way of that from zero, essentially, than has Russia through its sort of like expansion across North Eurasia.
As somebody who lives in southern Russia, I can strongly confirm this and say that from what I've seen, having traveled around Russia pretty extensively, it has better demographics than most of Western Europe at this point.
Okay. Brendan, you have the floor now.
Hi, Richard. My voice might sound different. I have a cough, but I would just say that... you said that we're going into the 20th century, and I disagree. I think we're seeing the last death of the 20th century. And I actually think that wokeism will win this war that Putin is waging against Ukraine. In fact, what right now wokeism is the probably you could say Apollo's secret weapon to unify the white race, just because it's the only unifying thing that will end up taking over all European countries, including Russia. So eventually, once everyone becomes woke, because that's the Zoomers, they don't identify with the 20th century. Once that happens, then you'll see all of this old world stuff and fighting between European factions will eventually just be absorbed into one giant hive mind. So that's what will happen eventually.
Interesting. Yeah, I mean, I think there's a bit of a contradiction of what I have been putting forth, because on the one hand, I have been saying that wokeism is this just virus that is inevitable on some level. On the other hand, I've been saying that I think there is going to be a lot of consolidation and kind of center-right politics with a clear geopolitical adversary and a kind of bipartisan foreign policy, which is what the United States had since Roosevelt on. But I think you might be... what you're saying might be almost a bit outlandish, but I don't think it's wrong. I don't think we can underestimate the degree to which wokeism is just a horrifying mind virus, and also the degree to which it is global.
Well, I don't think it's a horrifying mind virus, because like I just said, it's unifying more than it's dividing, if anything.
Huh.
Putin's attacking Apollo. He's being divisive. He's the one starting a war. And if you notice that, remember in 2016, there was a meme, AIDS, Greenland, and Karlin, where Owen Shore from Owen. And I can't remember what they were debating, but the AIDS, Greenland character screamed, "You're a white male." Right? And then his sidekick was like, "Are you kidding me?" But that was in... response to Troyer being just arguing with them, but they seem to care more about identity, the woke side, and the right. The right doesn't seem to care actually as much as they claim to. They really don't. If you look at the recent video of Lauren Witzko, that woman running for Senate in Delaware, saying that Putin is going to save the Christian world. It would all be like him. She wants him to rule the United States, basically. So that's not really unifying.
You're breaking up a lot. Is he breaking up for everyone else? He's breaking
up. Yeah, I can't.
Yes.
Okay. Well, Brendan, we're just going to... I can only hear about 50% of what you're saying. So I think we're just going to... move on. It's just not, it's not productive. Okay. You usually do say things that are very interesting, so I don't mean this to be rude. So, okay.
Can you hear me now?
Yeah, I can hear you now. Yes. Okay. So make your point. And then.
Okay. Sorry. I have no idea why it wasn't working. But when did I start to break up?
Well, I heard Lauren Witzke in there at some point.
Oh, okay. Yeah. She said basically that Putin didn't want us to save the Christian world. And, but really, the right is very divisive right now. And it's not have a vision for Europe. So,
yeah.
The woke side will, they're the ones who are basically unified, and the Western world's unified in support of Ukraine. And it's the woke side that has the nuclear weapons in the United States military. They have that as their ally, and the far right, it just has the internet. And so they have no power. The woke has more power right now. And when the alt-right 5 years ago was trying to promote itself, they would usually talk about the Holodomor in Ukraine and how Ukraine was a victim of Russia. And then the left would be like, oh, what are you talking about? There's no Holodomor. There's only the Holocaust. And now, all of a sudden, it's the far right that says Ukraine doesn't exist. And it's the center right and the center left and the woke world that's all unified in defending Ukraine. So this means that in the next few decades, the Zoomers and their wokeism will be unifying throughout all European countries as they take over institutions. And so what Putin is doing is a last gasp of the 20th century. And I think over a long period of time, his supporters will regret this invasion. But once the younger generations just start reshaping the world map and putting the Western world together with a new hive mind, then you'll see what's happening right now will turn out to be quite irrelevant.
Interesting perspective. I have noticed a major change. When I was much more sympathetic towards Russia than I am now, back in 2014, I was a lone voice. The alt-right, you know, didn't quite go by that name, or it did in many cases, but in 2014, the alt-right was very enthusiastic about dividing up Ukraine and promoting ethno-nationalism, this kind of stuff. I see a really strong reversal going on where, again, I'm biased, but this is my timeline. I just see a kind of a lot of, you know, kind of almost nihilistic or lashing out or just kind of based Putin, you know, posting going on where the dissident right is just, you know, basically like, oh yeah, Putin's a badass. We're going to, you know, kick in Western Europe and, you know, they'll send the tranny army out and the Russians will blast them away. Just this kind of very low level discourse. That's been a remarkable change. But I agree that kind of low level discourse is merely reactionary. There's nothing behind it. There's no actual vision. There's no real understanding of the situation. It's just basically social media lulls.
Right.
So,
interesting. And I'll just add that the woke side right now is the one promoting identity and trying to recognize and protect different groups, and this will extend to Europeans, and that will make them more united. So while the former alt-right acts divisive and just worships Putin, they'll be irrelevant in the future. They'll have no power because they have no vision, and actually the woke will take over everything, and then it might transform later into a more pro-European behavior, but wokeism is the precursor to that, actually. So that's where the power lies.
Well, as many have known, I've been on the liberal side a lot recently. Maybe I sense that as a strategy. But Rocco, do you want to jump in here?
Yeah, I just wanted to say I kind of agree with Brendan's point here that wokeism, I'm not going to necessarily say that wokeism is going to win, but I will agree with the point that wokeism has a unifying aspect currently that the right is lacking. So Putin is busy killing Ukrainians in order to, well, you know, something. And, you know, this kind of activity is, it's not politically powerful in the sense that people will not want to be part of a political movement that just sets everyone against everyone else. They're going to want to be part of a coalition. And wokeness gives people a coalition, right? It's kind of a weird, dysfunctional coalition. And I think that's perhaps where I disagree with Brendan, that actually when wokeness sort of runs out of control, it turns into San Francisco and everyone's a drug addict and transsexual and just complete dysfunctional human beings who can't get anything done. And then it kind of falls apart. So, you know, there doesn't necessarily have to be a logical purpose to wokeness, just like there doesn't have to be a logical purpose to cancer. When you get cancer, when you die of cancer, the cancer dies as well. But the cancer doesn't care, right? Like, it just is. It's just a thing in reality that follows certain rules and does its thing.
Well, I don't think the wokeness is an end to itself. I think it's a transition. So I think it'll take over everything first, and then it will transition into something else. So I don't think it'll fall apart. I think it'll continue spreading, and then it'll turn into it. It'll help unify Europe, and that's when things will change.
I would say this. I don't want this to sound rude. I don't think you can underestimate the lack of a compelling quality to Russia right now, and it was not always that way. If you were a serious intellectual in the first half of the 20th century and onward, you would at the very least see the Soviet Union as a hyper-progressive, futuristic, highly attractive entity. Now, obviously, the Frankfurt School was critical of the Soviet Union. New Left in the late 60s was critical of the Soviet Union, etc. But and again, even a kind of Americanism, if you want to give Americanism its due, there was a certain intelligentsia vision, a lot of it literally funded by the CIA, as we found out later, that was attractive and that it was compelling to intelligent people who are more important than just a single person. Russia now is not compelling. It's compelling to people like Laura Witsky, who are idiots. And they just like the idea of like, oh yeah, putting an illegal immigrant in prison or something. That kind of thing does not, and she claims she's a big Christian. That kind of thing does not go a long way. And it's not going to attract people of higher quality than Lauren Witsky, who is a former drug runner, by the way, but I mean, her type. And I don't think it can be underestimated the need of any kind of political order to have some kind of compelling vision that inspires intellectuals and, you know, it inspires people around the world to join it. And yes, wokeism goes totally insane. And obviously, I don't think anyone on this call likes, you know, transgenderism or something like that. But at the same time, a kind of cosmopolitan vision that is maybe kind of in the passenger seat of that, that actually can be attractive. I mean, if you are a educated, smart European who thinks highly of himself, you are going to be attracted to the European Union in a way that you're not going to be attracted to some kind of far-right anti-immigrant party in Norway. You just aren't. And that's just the fact. Yeah. There has to be a kind of compelling motive. And I think Brendan, as he often does, he'll kind of almost take Spencerist ideas and kind of push them further, but maybe overstate matters. But I think he's kind of on to something here. There has to be something that attracts people from around the world that feels like you're a part of something bigger. And I don't think Russia offers that at all. And the Soviet Union did. The American liberal age did.
And I will say that wokeism is the reason why Ukrainian refugees will be welcomed with so much sympathy. It's not the far right that's giving them sympathy anymore. They don't care about the genocide of Ukrainians anymore. Now it's all about being pro-Russia. So wokeism will take over being pro-refugee now.
Yeah, not in the dissident right. They don't care about them. And
I saw some posts on 4chan asking for female Ukrainian refugees in a certain age range, but
well, those are incel. They want to finally get laid. Thank you, Putin.
Mr. Spencer, may I reply to that? Because I mean, you kind of called me an idiot by association as somebody who did move to Russia and likes it here. I would like to explain if that's allowed.
Okay.
Quality of life is very good here. I come from the East Coast of the U.S., and every measurable thing that I could consider is better here in, you know, a major Russian city, despite several decades of strong sanctions, despite a low average income. It is a higher quality of life. The West has a significant problem. It has a lowering quality of life. It has a lower happiness, and a lot of this stems from demographic change. There is a strong effort to describe this away with environmental changes and that kind of thing, to come up with excuses for it. But as long as Russia exists, even if it manages to tread water in this current state, there will be a time within the next few decades when its quality of life is measurably and sharply better than that in the West. So the powers that be in our countries see this as a threat, I have no doubt, and have to respond to this. They have to bring Russia down, or else they're going to look like a bunch of clowns when a country that hasn't progressed in several decades looks better than they do, and people there live better than they do.
This is insane. I mean, what percentage of the population is below the poverty level in Russia? I mean, you can find certain anecdotes of, you know, really bad situation in the United States, like, no doubt, but Americans are going to start moving to Russia en masse for higher living standards. That's what you're claiming? I mean, that's totally outrageous.
Well, I mean, they're currently moving from San Francisco out to like Texas and stuff for basically this reason.
Oh yeah, look, 30.
Well, actually, like significantly support Dan's point, in fact, surprisingly enough, perhaps to some, in the sense that if you adjust for purchasing power parity, and like, because obviously prices differ, then yeah, I mean, the Russians on average are twice poorer than the US. However, my argument is that if you sort of equalize purchasing power, then the quality of life in Russia is substantially higher in the US. Frankly, a lot of Westerners have very out-of-date views, as if it was still the 1990s, where you have no amenities. Well, no, I mean, there's tons of interesting places and food courts and interesting restaurants and operas and whatever. So you can there's and laser arcades. There's a lot of scope for enjoying yourself, and they're obviously all a lot cheaper. So I mean, it differs category to category. If you're speaking of foreign manufactured goods, then yeah, they're as expensive as in the West, because these are global goods, tradable goods. If you're talking about food, say it's about twice cheaper. If you're saying if you're talking about the internet or telecommunications, it's about 10 times cheaper, literally. But yeah, on average, stuff is around twice cheaper. So, and salaries are 4 to 5 times lower than in the US. So this, in purely material terms, it translates into a difference of 2 to 2.5 times. But with the exception that, of course, in Russia there's no political correctness, there's the people are not sacks of suit walking around like you have in the US. So yeah, I mean, adjusting for those factors, if I would say that Russian quality of life is higher if you equalize purchasing power.
If I may just jump in for a second, was listening to that part of the conversation. I think that the proper way to compare quality of life and the purchasing power is not to take an anecdotal case of a Westerner. And Dan, I have no idea what your situation is, but typically an expat will not be earning the same income as an average Russian. So whether the same exists for in your region for an average local who perhaps makes significantly less and perhaps has access to fewer goods. I mean, yeah, you can live as an expat, and I lived as an expat in Kazakhstan and Russia for a number of years. Life is good. Everything is cheap relative to what you make. So very enjoyable. But that's a little bit of a not entirely representative.
Yeah.
Well, I mean, I think I sort of tried to address that. If you're talking about pure averages, then yes. In purely material terms, Russians are two and a half times poorer than the US. I think this is inevitable. This describes virtually all of Eastern Europe. So communism, the legacy of central planning, had heavily retardant effects. So all countries that spent part of the 20th century under communism, is a hard prediction that they would have a lower GDP per capita than comparable countries, than countries which are comparable to them in average IQ. So in terms of economic performance, Russia has been far from catastrophic relative to the rest of Eastern Europe. It's been much better than that of Ukraine, for instance, than Bulgaria. It's been worse than the Baltics and Poland. Although, you could say that Russia had access to oil dens, but on the other hand, the countries like Poland and the Baltics, which were in the EU, they had access to vast subsidies from Western Europe, as well as much greater institutional know-how transfer. In terms of code and law and regulations and so on, so I don't think this. So I mean, Russia is neither particularly poor by its sort of natural comparator group, which is Eastern Europe, nor has it significantly underperformed or overperformed relative to that group.
Okay. Master Sheikh, do you want to jump in, and then I might have to do a lightning round
regarding Russia and Russia's economics. There's one, we can sort of stretch and talk about different stats and stuff like that, how we interpret them. But there's this one thing about Russia that's really sort of very unsettling, is that Russia is actually among the so-called developed economies, the one that has the biggest wealth inequality. I mean, if we're talking about like 98% of wealth controlled by a few percent, then Russia is definitely up there. And the biggest tragedy, I think, of Vladimir Putin and modern Russia is this inequality, that really nothing has been done to sort of spread the wealth around in Russia. As someone from a country which borders Russia, I would love nothing more than well-developed, rich Russia as a trading partner. But unfortunately, that's not the case. And for years, Putin has, what he has done is accumulated wealth among his cronies, among his so-called wallets, which are these oligarchs like Abramovich and others. And this is the biggest problem, I think. And it's very sad that the Russian people, many Russian people, are in this situation of poverty, and that political corruption
and these other types of things that affect this inequality still persist. And Vladimir Putin is not doing anything to solve this. Instead, he's putting all the money into the military and invading his neighboring countries. And I think that's just an absolute no-go. And doing an invasion, well, in the past, when someone would do an invasion, they would have this speech that would rally up support for this and things like that. But in Putin's speeches, there's nothing but historical grievances towards the West. I mean, usually these pro-Russian types, they accuse like Eastern Europeans, like, oh, you just have historical grievances and you hate Russia because of that. But, well, I don't. And actually, before Brandon mentioned this, I think I haven't heard of the Holodomor in many years, actually. I remember some time ago, that would be the main thing that would always come up when talking about Ukraine, but I haven't really heard that in a while. And same as here, people, you may meet some stupid, idiotic nationalist online who will just go on a tangent about the crimes of communism and how evil the Soviet Union was against the Baltics. But I don't really think if you're serious, you're talking about these things nowadays. I mean, history is history. Yes, it's tragic, but the way Putin is talking about these historical grievances is just pathetic, I think. I mean, there's nothing like imperial or strong that projects strength about this when you're just complaining about how you've been mistreated in the past. I mean, move on. Come on.
Yes, I agree.
Well, I mean, that's a lot to go through, and obviously I have, I mean, those historical grievances can stretch indefinitely. I mean, the guys in the Holodomor, I can obviously point out that it wasn't, the famine wasn't limited to the to Ukraine. There was famine in the Volga, which was populated by Russians as well, and in northern Kazakhstan. And I mean, even talking about Latvia, I mean, without the dead Latvian riflemen, it's highly likely that the Bolsheviks would have survived the 1918. Yeah. But yes, I agree. It's
for the Soviet Union. Yeah.
Well, yeah, but
like
I mean,
small
if
small
people,
nation of
but if people, but if people,
the entire Russian,
but if people,
empire.
But
yeah,
if
okay,
people
hold on,
are going
talk,
to keep thinking it, but if people, but if Eastern Europeans keep bringing up these grievances, then I don't see why Russia should just shut itself up indefinitely and not throw the ball back at them if they insist on trolling us indefinitely.
No, I just made a point that I actually haven't, personally, I don't have any historical grievances about Russia. I mean, we can talk about history, but that's another discussion. And I think I've actually heard less and less historical grievances towards Russia in the past years. But it's the opposite in case of Russia and Putin in particular.
Putin's just making some new ones for you, okay?
Right.
But I mean, generally, I would kind of agree with the sentiment that, you know, and just coming back to what Brendan said, you know, you need a unifying ideology, right? You need people to find reasons to like each other and cooperate, rather than to find reasons to like invade each other and stuff. And I know that's kind of rich coming from somebody from the Balkans, but you know, that really is important.
Okay.
Just,
go ahead.
Jump. Oh, sure, Richard. Just a quick take on Master Sheikh's remark on inequality in Russia.
Yeah.
There was a study, if I remember correctly, in 2007 done by Credit Suisse that compared 100 plus countries in terms of the Gini coefficient, which is the kind of the accepted measure of income inequality, and Russia came up, if not the highest, maybe the second highest. And that was back in 2007. They don't do this often because it's pretty expensive to compile. You kind of make a lot of assumptions, and it's always somewhat of a judgment call comparing countries. But I can imagine since then it has only gotten worse. And for that reason, because so much of Russia's economy is driven by commodities prices, and basically natural rent is incorporated in it. Just judging by how high the standard of living is there by GDP per capita is not very representative, because much of that does not get distributed widely. It
kind
of finds its way to the elites. So that's all I wanted to say.
All right, I'm going to have to do this. I have to be somewhere in about 30 minutes. So I feel like if I start taking more questions, we're going to have, because everyone who is attracted to the space is very intelligent and has something to say. So I think I might just put a bookmark in this conversation. So thank you, Anatoly, for coming on. It's good. We haven't spoken in a while, so it's good to link up with you. And you can check out, you're on Substack and UNS. And definitely thank you, Master Sheikh. I think we've been doing some good spaces. We should keep doing them. Thanks to everyone who spoke up and added to the conversation. And thanks to everyone who listened. It's one of my bigger spaces. So obviously this is a topic we want to discuss. So I'll be doing this again. At the very least, I'll do one next Friday. I'm going to do a space every Friday, and I'll probably have to do one before then, because matters are advancing. But again, thank you. Thank you all for being here. And I really appreciate it. And I will talk to everyone soon.
Yeah, thank you.
Thank you. Thank you, Anatoly.
Okay. Okay. Yes. It was a pleasure being on your show, Richard.
Yes. Yeah. Pleasure is mine. All right. I will talk to you. I'm glad we didn't. I'm glad we didn't reproduce the current military campaign. Everyone is extremely civil. Very good.
Have a good evening, gentlemen.
All right. I'll talk to everyone soon. All right. Ciao.